You're watching Nevada Business Chronicles. Take a journey with us to see the innovative businesses that put Nevada on the business map. Connecting you with the businesses, events, and organizations that bring innovation and prosperity to the Nevada area, please welcome your host, Mitch Burney. If you've been watching the news, you may have seen this gentleman's face on it recently. Announced your candidacy for the 2018 race for Washoe County Sheriff. First of all, congratulations.
Thank you.
On announcing. And I also want to thank you for taking the time to sit down with us and talk about what platform you're standing on and getting to know you. I think a community is going to really enjoy that, so thank you.
It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Let's start with Adam Hopkins. What makes you qualified to become the next sheriff?
Mitch, that is a fantastic question. I'm glad you asked it. And I'm sure that the citizens of Washoe County absolutely have that on the top of their mind. Is this person qualified to be the sheriff of Washoe County? I'm here to tell you that I believe that I am the most qualified for this position. I have been in law enforcement for almost 26 years. I started with this department in 1990, and I worked my way through the ranks from deputy on up to lieutenant. I have been in various assignments throughout the sheriff's office. I know the inner workings of the sheriff's office. I know where they need to grow. I know where they need to head in different directions, both in technology and the management of people.
I think one of the questions that would also be at the forefront of people's mind when electing one of the highest positions in law enforcement in Washoe County would be a sheriff, would be, what is it that you're going to do? What change are you going to create, and how do you plan on getting there? So let's talk about your platform, your agenda.
One of the most important platforms that I have is the recidivism rate as it relates to inmates in our detention center.
Are you talking about the proverbial, let's take a bite out of crime that we've heard for the last decade and decade and decade?
I absolutely am not talking about that. Taking a bite out of crime is a reactionary action, reacting to the crime that's already occurred. Prior to crimes occurring, there are all kinds of things that factor into why crime is occurring. It is my intent to focus on what has caused the crime and not what we do after the crime has occurred.
I want to see if I understand what you're saying clearly. What I'm hearing is recidivism is caused by repetitive crime. And you're looking at ways to get in front of it before it ever occurs. This is a completely new way of thinking and seeing things.
Most of us have heard the slogan, protect and to serve. We've seen it on the side of patrol cars. We've seen it on the news. We've heard police agencies talking about protecting and serving the communities for decades. The protecting part is relatively easy. But what you don't hear a lot about is the serve part of law enforcement. I believe that service is absolutely the most important part. And so let's talk about that for a second. What does service actually mean? Well, in the context of law enforcement and the reduction of crime and the effect on recidivism, service means actually looking at the crime itself, breaking that crime down, and actually figuring out what the root cause of those crimes are. And then taking that information and having an effect on that root cause of the crime. Well, why would we want to do that? The reason we would want to do that is because by addressing the root cause, we can actually stop crime before it occurs in our communities.
You want to get in front of the crime before it ever happens, which is a completely different strategy than I think I've ever heard in law enforcement. How do you do that? How do you get in front of crime? Where do you start?
One way of doing that is through the use of something called the sequential intercept model, and that sounds very technical, but really it is not. It's a model that's been used, and it focuses frequently on dealing with people once they've been incarcerated and how you can insert yourself into the life of that person through the jail and through the court system and case management after they leave. It's my goal to take that model and put it out into the community. So when we have individuals that are having a problem with, say, drug addiction or alcohol addiction or mental health issues, that we can identify issues that they're having at the time, sign them up for classes, intercede in some way that provides them with help with whatever that problem is, so that that behavior stops there and doesn't snowball into a life of crime, ending up in our jail.
How do you plan on accomplishing that part of this model?
I am starting to form these community action partnerships right now, today. In fact, you can read about that on my website. You're going to hear more about the very first CAP team that we are forming. And I'm going to continue to work on that through the entire election and for the next 4 years. So really what that means is that I will be working on these for the next 5 years. I have 5 years to actually make a difference in this community, to do things different than law enforcement has ever been done in this community before, and to include the community in every aspect of solving these problems that are affecting us so greatly.
What you're talking about is really bringing them together as a collaborative effort if you're going to take community involvement to that level. So let's kind of talk about how a partnership, community action partnership, CAP program even came to your mind.
I've been working with some of the most creative people in this community recently. People who have come up with ideas to affect people's lives in ways that we've never seen. As an example, the Crossroads program. I work closely with those who have created it. Crossroads is affecting people's lives that have been incarcerated, that have the need to be helped with wraparound services, that are in the court system, and it's affecting their lives. It's affecting the taxpayer dollar, the amount that we're spending on inmates, the bed days within the jail, the bed days at hospitals and medical transports. It's a fantastic program. I've been working with people who are deeply involved in the Sober 24 program, which you ran a story on in your program recently. So I said to myself, how can we come up with these programs to affect other problems within our community? And I thought, what better way than to just reach out and ask for help from the community? Tell people that I know that they have great ideas, that they understand what these problems are. For the most part, these are going to be people that are either professionals in the field or people where crime or addiction or drug abuse has actually affected their lives. Those are the people that I want. Why do I want them? Because they have the passion. They have the desire. They've had negative effects from these things happening in their lives. So I'm sure they're sitting around wondering, when is somebody going to actually ask me what I think? And that's what I'm doing. I'm asking them what they think. And then I'm going to try to implement them.
Typically, we see law enforcement over here and we see community over here. And any of these great ideas typically cost taxpayer dollars, but this was unique.
Well, what it was law enforcement and other agencies thinking outside of a box. What we tend to do in law enforcement is think inside that box. We limit ourselves. We do things the way we have always done it. There are times when we have tried new and innovative programs, and I applaud people for doing that. But in my administration, we are not only going to think outside of that box, we're going to throw that box completely out the window. We are going to try things that no one else has tried. As long as it's not illegal or immoral, we're going to consider everything. And when you talk about how these programs are funded, you're absolutely correct. They are normally funded through government funds, taxpayer dollars.
Controlled by government red tape.
That's exactly right. So by using the community action partners to come up with innovative ideas, to help us fund those programs. Now, it might take some seed money. So I'm not going to sit here and tell you that it's going to be a free ride for government. But what it will mean is that when governments are limiting their funding based on the economic status of our community, those programs that are created through this community action partnership will be less impacted, if impacted at all, because it's not reliant on those government funds.
You're talking about sustainability.
That's exactly right. And if it's created outside of government, we're not dealing with all of that government red tape. I have spent years working within that government red tape.
It's restrictive.
In fact, it makes it so that certain programs absolutely cannot be done, and I refuse to say that.
I think that's one of the things that impacted me the most about Crossroads and Sober 24 is how far out of the box. I mean, you're right, there really wasn't a box in that critical thinking and that collaboration. And they're not relying on government funding. It's sustainable. And I think that one of the advantages that I've seen is they've been able to morph that program. They've been able to make it fit the needs of our community. And one of the things that I was talking to Deputy Sheriff Sean Martian about was that in our community, we have a very large population of drug addicted individuals compared to many other communities where it may be alcohol addicted. And that their program, they were able to shift how this program was going based off of the current and right now needs. And I thought, if we have a government-based written program, protocol, it doesn't have that kind of flexibility. And I thought that it was brilliant. But what was fascinating is the communities over here really running and supporting it, but law enforcement is still involved in it and supporting it, and the judicial system is in there supporting it. I think that the concept of creating these partnerships is absolutely brilliant, and more of them the community is going to embrace with open arms. I want to hear about your Ground Zero initiative.
So I am committed to creating what I'm calling a Ground Zero unit. Within the Crossroads system, they have five different stages. This will be stage zero. This is where we will put a Crossroads-like unit within the sheriff's office, within the jail, and we will find those inmates who are drug addicted, are alcohol addicted, or have mental health issues that want to get ahead of that, want to get help with that, and want to follow the rules of our facility, and we're going to house them in that facility. Within that facility, we're going to offer them the same programs that they have if they were to be in the actual in-house Crossroads program. What that does is that allows us to start their recovery and helping them from the minute they get to that jail.
The fact that you're going to take these types of problems on is so inspiring for me right now. After visiting the Crossroads program, they're currently housing 136 men and women. There's 100 people on a waiting list. Now, some people are going to ask a couple of different questions about this. Why should we be offering treatment for people that are addicted to drugs and alcohol? And isn't this a soft way of treating criminals? Where is that line, and how does that occur for you?
What we're doing by creating programs like this, like Crossroads, I don't know if you realize this, but it costs $126 a day to house an inmate in the Washoe County Jail. And if those people have a drug addiction or an alcohol addiction or are mentally ill, you can double or even triple that cost. And you know what else is incredible? And that people just don't realize, they're not thinking about, is that those people that are in Crossroads, they're putting their lives back together. They're going to end up being productive members of society. And while they're doing that, they're not out committing crimes. They're not making victims of our citizens. They're not robbing and stealing and hurting people in order to feed those habits. These are the programs that we need. These are the programs that we need to double down on. And that's something that I absolutely commit to doing throughout my candidacy and throughout my term as sheriff.
Wow. I'm present to something right now that you were mentioning all the things that these individuals were not doing in the way of crime. And I'm sure there's somebody out there right now that's lost somebody to a drunk driver, an addicted individual that was high on something, and deaths. And we pick up the newspaper, we turn on the news, and we hear about the crisis, the drug crisis in our country. And you're actually talking about it, how it impacts our law enforcement, how it impacts our incarceration rates, our recidivism rates, and not just talking about it as crime.
For every day we wait, we are putting people's lives at risk. Mm. We are allowing another person to be a victim of crime that we might be able to affect positively, that we can help people through so that they're no longer in our system.
Well, that is absolutely true. And just a new way of thinking.
Well, it's not only a new way of thinking, but it's a new way of acting, and a new way of being, and a new way of
seeing. Right.
It's a new way of seeing.
You know, there's one thing I hope that you'll indulge me in talking about before we close this segment and have you come back for another one, is your campaign. You have shared with me that this is going to be a campaign for office that nobody's ever seen before either. So if you wouldn't mind, I really would like to talk about what that looks like, because I think it's going to surprise people, and it is one of the core reasons why I've asked you to be here and to talk about your platforms. But talk to me about a campaign in running for office. What's different about yours?
I will not run a negative campaign. I will not throw mud at any other candidate. If they throw mud at me, that's fine and I'll deal with that. But I will not throw it back. I want people to understand that there is a better alternative than to have someone in office who would resort to throwing mud. Their alternative is me. Their alternative is plans and partnerships.
So action.
And if you want plans and partnerships and actions, you'll vote for me.
I'm not sure how negative campaigns occur to other people in the world or in our community, but to me, with all the conversation of bullying and the message of anti-bullying, it appears to me that politics in general are the biggest group of bullies attacking each other and, like you call it, throwing mud. I think it's more graphically disturbing than that. And for that reason, you have my vote. I'm telling you that this needs to be something that's recreated. And if this is the way you're going to act now, I can count on you as sheriff, and I'll be honored to give you my vote. So thank you so much for being on our show.
I appreciate it. Thanks, Mitch.
For more information on this guest or to see this show in its entirety, visit nvbusinesschronicles.com. While you're there, you can watch all of our past shows on the Chronicles page and stay connected with us by following us on our social media. Now more from Nevada Business Chronicles.
We're back at Carpenter's Music World, and one thing I realized last time we were here is you cannot cover Carpenter's Music World in one episode. Thanks so much for having us back.
It's a pleasure.
Back to school, it's a big time for families. But it's also a big time at Carpenter's Music World because you have instruments for every need.
We have a very comprehensive rental program. There are a few objectives that we try to achieve. One is that they have a fine instrument. So teachers are very particular about that. And the better the instrument, the more likely the child will be to play it and enjoy it. The faster they'll progress. The other thing that we have that's a very comprehensive line, so they, if they wanted to play different types of instruments, they start out on violin and wind up on tuba, or start out on a tuba and wind up with a piccolo. All of these things are available.
So are you telling me that people start to play one instrument, students going to school,
go into band or orchestra and decide they're going to play one instrument, but then change their minds. They're poor parents.
Yeah. Well, sometimes if they start on a clarinet and all they get is squeaks and squawks for the first time, the parents can't take that. So short of hiding the reed or getting rid of the mouthpiece, they can change the instruments to a trumpet where they sound a little bit better.
That's fantastic. Or if the student just decides, oh, I see that instrument, I didn't even think about that, that looks like more fun for me, or picks it up and finds out that they're capable of playing that one better, they may choose to.
Yeah, sometimes there are cute girls playing the trumpet or something, and they decide, oh, the trumpet would be for me. That's great.
What about new and used, and how does the rental program work?
The rental program is set up so that they can actually change instruments if they're renting one instrument. And we have new and used instruments. They can rent at pretty moderate prices. And if they start out on an instrument and they're accruing equity, that equity can transfer from one instrument to another.
Today, we're going to get to meet one of your violin instructors, which I think is one of the beauties of Carpenter's Music World, is the diversity of what you do here isn't just that you sell instruments, you can teach, and you have instructors as well on the property.
That is correct.
Well, let's meet your instructor.
Mitch, I'd like you to meet our violin instructor, Marie.
Nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you.
We're trying to get rid of the violins, and so she's a violin teacher and teaches also cello, bass, all of the stringed instruments.
How hard is it for you to teach somebody how to play violin?
My job is to make sure that I can break it down in a way that it's accessible to every single person that comes to me to learn an instrument.
So even somebody that has all thumbs, you can teach me how to play the violin?
Absolutely, and I'd love to show you your potential when it comes to playing the violin.
I'd love to be taught. This is exciting. Let's do it.
You make a little bunny with your right hand. And how we make a bunny, if you've ever done like a shadow puppet bunny?
Yes.
We want to make sure we have two bunny teeth here. And if we flip over, your thumb looks like a mountain. Pretty easy stuff to remember. Let's flip back over. I want you to open the bunny's mouth. And all I'm going to do is just put this bow right in your hand. And we're going to come down, bring this bunny ear right to the top. First finger down. Now you know how to hold the bow.
Okay, that seems awkward.
Yes, it quite is at first. There is one thing we're going to check, and we're going to make sure your thumb looks like a mountain. So we're going to bring this out. Open. Mountain thumb.
Mountain thumb.
You see the bump there? You know that's a mountain thumb. Now, of course, it is quite challenging at first to get this bow grip down.
Got it.
But with weekly lessons, you'll get it in no time.
Actually, it balances in here. At some level, it actually does fit right.
That is exactly what I like to hear. Now, the first step to making a sound on the instrument is to be able to place your bow on the string silently. It's kind of tricky,
isn't
it?
Oh, that is as easy as it sounds.
It's not. Oh, there you go. That's exactly what we want. Now, this time, I want to challenge you, and we're going to aim to be close to the bridge here.
Okay.
We're gonna land right between the bridge. So let's fly away and we're gonna try to land in that exact spot. No sound. Oh, that looks great. And I'm checking your thumb and it still looks like a mountain. That's exactly what we want. So now we're ready to bow across the instrument. And for the first time, I'm going to bow with you here. And we're gonna bow together just so we can get this motion down. Before we start, I want you to just release your bow grip and make it nice and relaxed. Yes. First thing we're going to do is just bow down and up. You try. That's a nice sound for the first time putting your bow on the instrument.
I've never done this, so help me God.
That is really awesome.
Actually didn't sound that bad.
Yeah. Let's try a different string. We're going to move up one string. We're going to go here. We're gonna bow together once, but first I want you to release your grip here.
Okay.
You try. That's a nice resonant sound.
Wow.
And I think part of it is really that you are starting on such a nice quality instrument.
I can hear that. That really does sound nice. You know, I was thinking that the dogs were gonna run and the cars were gonna crash. But that actually
that comes later.
Well, this actually looks doable. You're a terrific instructor, by the way.
Oh, thank you very much.
I'm shocked. I really am shocked, Wendell. I didn't expect to take even a couple of strokes without, you know, the ambulance showing up and somebody burst their eardrums. And I think that really does kind of inspire me to really be excited about the fact that maybe I can do this.
That's a wonderful thing about having a good teacher. Maria is one of the finest in violins here, and we just appreciate having her. It makes such a difference when you have a teacher to start out with. You avoid making mistakes on the instrument instead of correcting mistakes that you've picked up through internet instruction or other types of things. Try and pick it up on your own. It's not the same.
I can also see that if you have somebody like Maria, I mean, just fantastic. You made that so easy. I mean, I was not expecting that to be that easy to pick up. And I think if you have that you can really get into the instrument and the music. And if you don't have that same first experience, it could discourage you from something that you could have thoroughly enjoyed if you met somebody like Marie. Now, you teach violin, viola, and cello?
That's correct.
And you have other instructors, I'm assuming, for all the different instruments?
Yes, we do, and that's key. In unlocking your musical potential at Carpenters, there are three major components. One is a child with a desire to learn.
Or an adult.
Yeah, or an adult that supports that child, or an adult too. The second is to have proper instruction. And Maria is a good example of a fine instructor, as you found out.
Unbelievable. I was really impressed.
The third is a good instrument. And we've actually talked about that and what a fine instrument does in the hands of a student. Now, that's all key in developing your musical potential. And at Carpenters, we have lessons on all of the instruments, all of band and orchestral instruments, as well as guitars, both rock and roll, folk, classical, and also voice lessons.
You can unlock your musical potential at Carpenters Music World, located at 1090 Kitsky Lane. You can give them a call at 775-852-7618 or on the internet at carpentersmusic.com. Marie, could you take us out? This guest, or to see this show in its entirety, visit nvbusinesschronicles.com. While you're there, you can watch all of our past shows on the Chronicles page and stay connected with us by following us on our social media. For information on becoming a guest on our show, contact us at info@nvbusinesschronicles.com. We hope you enjoyed the show. Thanks for watching. Tune in next week at the same time for more from Nevada Business Chronicles.